Chapter 1: The Essential Discipline. Yesterday, Alan came over to visit with his son, Joey. Joey has grown so quickly. He's already 7 years old and is fluent in French and English. He even uses a bit of slang he's picked up on the street. Raising children here is very different from the way we raise children at home. Here, parents believe that freedom is necessary for a child's development. During the 2 hours that Alan and I were talking, Alan had to keep a constant eye on Joey. Joey played, chattered away, and interrupted us, making it impossible to carry on a real conversation. I gave him several picture books for children, but he barely glanced at them before tossing them aside and interrupting our conversation again. He demands the constant attention of grown-ups. Later, Joey put on his jacket and went outside to play with a neighbor's child. I asked Alan, "Do you find family life easy?" Alan didn't answer directly. He said that during the past few weeks, since the birth of Anna, he had been unable to sleep any length of time. During the night, Sue wakes him up and, because she is too tired herself, asks him to check to make sure Anna is still breathing. I get up and look at the baby and then come back and fall asleep again. Sometimes the ritual happens 2 or 3 times a night. LS family life easier than being a bachelor? I asked. Alan didn't answer directly, but I understood. I asked another question. A lot of people say that if you have a family, you're less lonely and have more security. Is that true? Alan nodded his head and mumbled something softly, but I understood. Then Alan said, "Love discovered a way to have a lot more time. In the past, I used to look at my time as if it were divided into several parts. One part I reserved for Joey, another part was for Sue, another part to help with Anna, another part for household work. The time left over I considered my own." I could read, write, do research, go for walks. But now I try not to divide time into parts anymore. I consider my time with Joey and Sue as my own time. When I help Joey with his homework, I try to find ways of seeing his time as my own time. I go through his lesson with him, sharing his presence and finding ways to be interested in what we do during that time. The time for him becomes my own time. The same with Sue. The remarkable thing is that now I have unlimited time for myself. Alan smiled as he spoke. I was surprised. I knew that Alan hadn't learned this from reading any books. This was something he had discovered for himself in his own daily life. Washing the dishes to wash the dishes. 30 years ago, when I was still a novice at Tuhir Pagoda, washing the dishes was hardly a pleasant task. During the season of retreat, when all the monks returned to the monastery, 2 novices had to do all the cooking and wash the dishes for sometimes well over 100 monks. There was no soap, We had only ashes, rice husks, and coconut husks, and that was all. Cleaning such a high stack of bowls was a chore, especially during the winter when the water was freezing cold. Then you had to heat up a big pot of water before you could do any scrubbing. Nowadays, one stands in a kitchen equipped with liquid soap, special scrub pads, and even running hot water, which makes it all the more agreeable. It is easier to enjoy washing the dishes now. Anyone can wash them in a hurry, then sit down and enjoy a cup of tea afterwards. I can see a machine for washing clothes, although I wash my own things out by hand, but a dishwashing machine is going just a little too far. While washing the dishes, one should only be washing the dishes, which means that while washing the dishes, one should be completely aware of the fact that one is washing the dishes. At first glance, that might seem a little silly. Why put so much stress on a simple thing? But that's precisely the point. The fact that I am standing there and washing these bowls is a wondrous reality. I'm being completely myself, following my breath, conscious of my presence, and conscious of my thoughts and actions. There's no way I can be tossed around mindlessly, like a bottle slapped here and there on the waves. The cup in your hands. In the United States, I have a close friend named Jim Forrest. When I first met him 8 years ago, he was working with the Catholic Peace Fellowship. Last winter, Jim came to visit. I usually wash the dishes after we finished the evening meal, before sitting down and drinking tea with everyone else. One night, Jim asked if he might do the dishes. I said, "Go ahead, but if you wash the dishes, you must know the way to wash them." Jim replied, "Come on, you think I don't know how to wash the dishes?" I answered, "There are two ways to wash the dishes. The first is to wash the dishes in order to have clean dishes, and the second is to wash the dishes in order to wash the dishes." Jim was delighted and said, "I choose the second way to wash the dishes, to wash the dishes." From then on, Jim knew how to wash the dishes. I transferred the responsibility to him for an entire week. If while washing dishes, we think only of the cup of tea that awaits us, thus hurrying to get the dishes out of the way as if they were a nuisance, then we are not washing the dishes to wash the dishes. What's more, we are not alive during the time we are washing the dishes. In fact, we are completely incapable of realizing the miracle of life while standing at the sink. If we can't wash the dishes, the chances are we won't be able to drink our tea either. While drinking the cup of tea, we will only be thinking of other things, barely aware of the cup in our hands. Thus, we are sucked away into the future, and we are incapable of actually living 1 minute of life. Eating a tangerine. I remember a number of years ago when Jim and I were first traveling together in the United States. We sat under a tree and shared a tangerine. He began to talk about what we would be doing in the future. Whenever we thought about a project that seemed attractive or inspiring, Jim became so immersed in it that he literally forgot about what he was doing in the present. He popped a section of tangerine in his mouth, and before he had begun chewing it, had another slice ready to pop into his mouth again. He was hardly aware he was eating a tangerine. All I had to say was, "You ought to eat the tangerine section you've already taken." Jim was startled into realizing what he was doing. It was as if he hadn't been eating the tangerine at all. If he had been eating anything, he was eating his future plans. Our tangerine has sections. If you can eat just one section, you can probably eat the entire tangerine. But if you can't eat a single section, you cannot eat the tangerine. Jim understood. He slowly put his hand down and focused on the presence of the slice already in his mouth. He chewed it thoughtfully before reaching down and taking another section. Later, when Jim went to prison for activities against the war, I was worried about whether he could endure the four walls of prison and sent him a very short letter. Zero. You remember the tangerine we shared when we were together? Your being there is like the tangerine. Eat it and be one with it. Tomorrow it will be no more. The Essential Discipline. More than 30 years ago, when I first entered the monastery, the monks gave me a small book called The Essential Discipline for Daily Use, written by the Buddhist monk Dr. From Bausong Pagoda, and they told me to memorize it. It was a thin book. It couldn't have been more than 40 pages, but it contained all the thoughts Doc used to awaken his mind while doing any task. When he woke up in the morning, his first thought was, "Just awakened, I hope that every person will attain great awareness and see in complete clarity." When he washed his hands, he used this thought to place himself in mindfulness. "Washing my hands, I hope that every person will have pure hands to receive reality." The book is comprised entirely of such sentences. Their goal was to help the beginning practitioner take hold of his own consciousness. The Zen Master Doc. They helped all of us young novices to practice, in a relatively easy way, those things which are taught in the Sutra of Mindfulness. Each time you put on your robe, washed the dishes, went to the bathroom, folded your mat, carried buckets of water, or brushed your teeth, you could use one of the thoughts from the book in order to take hold of your own consciousness. The Sutra of Mindfulness says, when walking, the practitioner must be conscious that he is walking. When sitting, the practitioner must be conscious that he is sitting. When lying down, the practitioner must be conscious that he is lying down. No matter what position one's body is in, the practitioner must be conscious of that position. Practicing thus, the practitioner lives in direct and constant mindfulness of the body. The mindfulness of the positions of one's body is not enough, however. We must be conscious of each breath, each movement, every thought and feeling, everything which has any relation to ourselves. But what is the purpose of the sutra's instruction? Where are we to find the time to practice such mindfulness? If you spend all day practicing mindfulness, how will there ever be enough time to do all the work that needs to be done to change and to build an alternative society? How does Alan manage to work, study Joey's lesson, take Anna's diapers to the laundromat, and practice mindfulness at the same time? In the sutras, Buddha usually teaches that one should use one's breath in order to achieve concentration. The sutra which speaks about the use of your breath to maintain mindfulness is the Anapanasati Sutra. This sutra was translated and commentated on by a Vietnamese Zen master of Central Asian origin named Kuong Thang Hoi around the beginning of the 3rd century AD. Anapana means breath and sati means mindfulness. Thang Hoi translated it as guarding the mind. The Anapanasati Sutra, that is the sutra on using one's breath to maintain mindfulness. The sutra on breath to maintain mindfulness is the 118th sutra in the Majjhima Nikaya collection of sutras, and it teaches 16 methods of using one's breath. Chapter 2. The miracle is to walk on earth. Alan said that since he's begun to consider Joey's and Sue's time as his own, he has unlimited time. But perhaps he has it only in principle, because there are doubtless times when Alan forgets to consider Joey's time as his own time while going over Joey's homework with him, and thus Alan may lose that time. Alan might hope for the time to pass quickly, or he may grow impatient because that time seems wasted to him, because it isn't his own time. And so, if he really wants unlimited time, he will have to keep alive the realization that this is my time throughout the time he's studying with Joey. But during such times, one's mind is inevitably distracted by other thoughts. And so, if one really wants to keep one's consciousness alive, from now on, 111 used the term mindfulness to refer to keeping one's consciousness alive to the present reality, then one must practice right now in one's daily life, not only during meditation sessions, when you are walking along a path leading into a village, you can practice mindfulness. Walking along a dirt path surrounded by patches of green grass, if you practice mindfulness, you will experience that path, the path leading into the village. You practice by keeping this one thought alive. I'm walking along the path leading into the village. Whether it's sunny or rainy, whether the path is dry or wet, you keep that one thought, but not just repeating it like a machine, over and over again. Machine thinking is the opposite of mindfulness. If we're really engaged in mindfulness while walking along the path to the village, then we will consider the act of each step we take as an infinite wonder, and a joy will open our hearts like a flower, enabling us to enter the world of reality. I like to walk alone on country paths. Rice plants and wild grasses on both sides, putting each foot down on the earth in mindfulness, knowing that I walk on the wondrous earth. In such moments, existence is a miraculous and mysterious reality. People usually consider walking on water or in thin air a miracle. But I think the real miracle is not to walk either on water or in thin air, but to walk on earth. Every day, we are engaged in a miracle which we don't even recognize. A blue sky, white clouds, green leaves, the black, curious eyes of a child, our own two eyes. All is a miracle. The poet Nguyen Khong Tru experienced the same thing when he sat down on a certain spot and suddenly saw how others had sat on the same spot countless ages ago, and how in ages to come others would also come to sit there. On the same spot I sit today, others came in ages past to sit. 1,000 years, still others will come. Who is the singer and who the listener? That spot and the minutes he spent there became a link in eternal reality. But active, concerned people don't have time to spend leisurely walking along paths of green grass and sitting beneath trees. One must prepare projects, consult with the neighbors, try to resolve a million difficulties. There is hard work to do. One must deal with every kind of hardship, every moment, keeping one's attention focused on the work, alert, ready to handle the situation ably and intelligently. You might well ask, then how are we to practice mindfulness? My answer is, keep your attention focused on the work, be alert and ready to handle ably and intelligently any situation which may arise. This is mindfulness. There is no reason why mindfulness should be different from focusing all one's attention on one's work, to be alert, and to be using one's best judgment. During the moment one is consulting, resolving, and dealing with whatever arises, a calm heart and self-control are necessary if one is to obtain good results. Anyone can see that. If we are not in control of ourselves, but instead let our impatience or anger interfere, then our work is no longer of any value. Mindfulness is the miracle by which we master and restore ourselves. Consider, for example, a magician who cuts his body into many parts and places each part in a different region, hands in the south, arms in the east, legs in the north, and then by some miraculous power lets forth a cry which reassembles whole every part of his body. Mindfulness is like that. It is the miracle which can call back in a flash our dispersed mind and restore it to wholeness so that we can live each minute of life. Taking hold of one's breath. Thus, mindfulness is at the same time a means and an end, the seed and the fruit. When we practice mindfulness in order to build up concentration, mindfulness is a seed. But mindfulness itself is the life of awareness. The presence of mindfulness means the presence of life, and therefore mindfulness is also the fruit. Mindfulness frees us of forgetfulness and dispersion, and makes it possible to live fully each minute of life. Mindfulness enables us to live. You should know how to breathe to maintain mindfulness, as breathing is a natural and extremely effective tool which can prevent dispersion. Breath is the bridge which connects life to consciousness, which unites your body to your thoughts. Whenever your mind becomes scattered, use your breath as the means to take hold of your mind again. Breathe in lightly. A fairly long breath, conscious of the fact that you are inhaling a deep breath. Now breathe out all the breath in your lungs, remaining conscious the whole time of the exhalation. The Sutra of Mindfulness teaches the method to take hold of one's breath in the following manner. Be ever mindful you breathe in and mindful you breathe out. Breathing in a long breath, you know, I am breathing in a long breath. Breathing out a long breath, you know, I am breathing out a long breath. Breathing in a short breath, you know, I am breathing in a short breath. Breathing out a short breath, you know, I am breathing out a short breath. Experiencing a whole breath body, I shall breathe in, thus you train yourself. Experiencing the whole breath body, I shall breathe out, thus you train yourself. Calming the activity of the breath body, I shall breathe in, thus you train yourself. Calming the activity of the breath body, I shall breathe out, thus you train yourself. In a Buddhist monastery, everyone learns to use breath as a tool to stop mental dispersion and to build up concentration power. Concentration power is the strength which comes from practicing mindfulness. It is the concentration which can help one obtain the great awakening. When a worker takes hold of his own breath, he has already become awakened. In order to maintain mindfulness throughout a long period, we must continue to watch our breath. It is autumn here, and the golden leaves falling one by one are truly beautiful. Taking a low-minute walk in the woods, watching my breath and maintaining mindfulness, I feel refreshed and restored. Like that, I can really enter into a communion with each leaf. Of course, walking alone on a country path, it is easier to maintain mindfulness. If there's a friend by your side, not talking but also watching his breath, then you can continue to maintain mindfulness without difficulty. But if the friend at your side begins to talk, it becomes a little more difficult.